There are many YouTube videos about how to create basic UIs in Godot. But once we have a UI, then what? In this video, we'll look at how to create a system that makes your UI implementation maintainable and flexible. Here's a menu in which the player can hire heroes to build their party. We have a list of available heroes that are for hire on the left, and a list on the right which contains all hired party members. When a hero is selected, all their information is shown in the center. I went ahead and implemented the logic, so let's see it in action. When I select a hero, the information box in the center appears and updates with that hero's info. I can click Hire to move a hero from the available list to the hired list, or Remove them to move them back to the available list. When I change the name, the change automatically affects all other nodes that display the name, like this item in the list over here. Also note that the selection updates accordingly, and only one item from one of the two lists can be selected at any given time. So how would you actually code all of this? Let's talk about the most obvious but not so great way of doing things first. You could just write a script that hardcodes all interactions in your UI. For each component, you code what happens when it changes. When a hero is selected, you set the line edits text to the name of the selected hero and update all labels that display their stats. When the line edits text changes, you update the selected item's label and anything else that uses the name, and so on. This works fine for simple user interfaces. But as your UI grows, it becomes difficult to change, logic becomes complicated, and it generates a lot of code which is hard to maintain. So how can we do this better? There are many design patterns like model view controller, model view view model, model view presenter, and more that can be used to manage a UI. To simplify, these are just ways to separate the logic and visible content of your controls from the data the UI ultimately manipulates. For our purposes, we're just going to ignore the details of the design patterns and instead focus on the idea of separating our data from our nodes in Godot. Just be aware, what we're going to do in this video is just one way of managing the UI, but it's what I found to complement Godot's node system quite well. Really, there are only two things we need to deal with: the state and controls. The state is all data that you may want the UI to affect. In my example, that's two arrays of hero objects where each hero has some data like a name. Of course, in my example, they had more data than just a name. They also had stats. But that doesn't fit nicely into this diagram. Controls, on the other hand, are any control nodes which the player can see and usually interact with. That could be buttons, labels, checkboxes, line edits, and so on. Our goal is to tie the state to our controls somehow. If the state changes, we update the control, and when the control changes, we update the state. Note that our control nodes in Godot often have an internal state of their own. For example, a line edit contains state like the text it currently displays. So really, we're linking our state to this internal state of the line edit. To make sure the different controls don't know too much about each other, we're going to use signals to do all the communication. Here's how it'll work. Say we have our state, a line edit, and a label. When I type something into the line edit, the text changed signal is emitted, which we'll connect a function to that updates the state. Meanwhile, the state contains a value changed signal that we connect to another function, which writes the data into our label's text property. By going through these signals, we're avoiding any direct interaction between our two controls. Our components are now completely independent from each other and only ever interact with the state. That's a huge improvement. The UI can now be changed easily later on, logic stays simple because each component only worries about itself, and we end up with less code, which is easier to maintain. So how do we implement all this? Again, our controls already have signals that we can connect to see if their internal state changes. For example, the text changed signal in a line edit. We can simply connect a function to this, and that modifies the state. Personally, I like using lambda functions to make this very compact. Like this single line of code, which updates the name of our selected hero based on what text the player enters. Ignore the properties called value for a second, you'll see what those are all about soon. Anyway, detecting changes to our state is a little bit more complicated. We could just use setters to detect a change in our state and call some custom signal. So in this example, when my value is modified, value changed is emitted to signal the change. But this is where things get tricky. First of all, this doesn't work well with arrays. Here we are doing exactly what we did before, but use an array instead of an integer. Sure, if we set an entire array, the setter is called. But when we append a value into the array, the setter is never called. This is a problem, since we would like to work with arrays in our UI for lists and such. The other problem is that this ends up generating a lot of boilerplate code. You end up with a ton of setters and signals, and that makes everything very messy. To fix both of these issues, we need to create a few helper classes. First is a base class I like to call Reactive, as it will allow us to define types that react to change. I like to make this Reactive class extend resource. And as you can see, all it contains is a signal that we can emit when the Reactive object changes. But let's add one more thing, the ability for Reactive objects to have an owner. First, I've added this owner property and given it a setter. If this property is set to a valid Reactive object rather than null, then we can connect the owner's propagate function to the Reactive's signal. This propagate function simply emits the signal, which essentially propagates the signal up the chain of owners. Sounds complicated, but it's really simple. Let's say we have a hero class, which extends Reactive. Inside the class, we have variables for the hero's name, strength, wisdom, and so on. All of these are also objects of type Reactive. Now, what happens if I emit the Reactive change signal of the name property? Well, it will emit, and that's it. But if you think about it, the hero should also emit its Reactive change signal. After all, if I rename a hero, that implies that the hero itself has changed, right? So, we set the owner of name, strength, wisdom, and other properties to be the hero. This will automatically propagate changes to these properties by emitting the signal of the hero at the same time. If, for example, the name emits its signal, then its owner, the hero, will too. Now that we have our Reactive type working, let's add some subclasses like Reactive Int, Reactive String, and stuff like that. These are going to store the actual values that make up our data, like integers or strings. Sadly, Godot doesn't have generic types like we can have with templates in C++, for example, so we're going to create multiple subclasses as a workaround. As you can see, all these subclasses do is store an internal value, here either an int or a string. When they are set, the signal is emitted. And to be able to quickly set the owner, the init function takes an initial owner as well. For arrays, I want to create another subclass, ReactiveArray, which wraps all common array operations and makes sure they also emit the signal after completion. This way we can have arrays that react to change properly as well. And finally, I would like to be able to store any other object, like a hero, for example, or another reactive. So let's create a reactive object class. This is just for convenience, as it allows us to avoid having a million subclasses for every imaginable type of object. As you can see, if the reactive object's value is set to another reactive, we also propagate its signal to the reactive object. This is really nice for having nested reactives. And there we go. That was a lot of setup, but that's all we need to build our state and connect controls to it. In my example, we need to track two arrays of heroes. Of course, we need to actually code the hero class, which inherits from Reactive. Its properties like name, strength, wisdom, and so on are Reactive subclasses that set the hero as their owner. Remember, that just means if they change, the hero itself changed as well. And that's it for the state. It's actually quite simple. By the way, the state is just a node which I set up as an autoload. This makes it exist in the background and keeps it easily accessible. Of course, you can store your state wherever and however you like. Okay, all of the steps we went through may have seemed like a lot of effort. But now that we have everything set up properly, making UI interactions work is super easy. And the system will make it stay manageable even as things become more complex. Let's look at the code for the menu I showed you as an example. This script is attached to the root of my menu, which is a control node. The first thing we define is some extra state that is only relevant to this menu, which is the currently selected hero. The entire rest of the logic simply goes into the ready function. First, we set the selection of our two lists to be the same reactive we're using for our selected hero. This is really neat because it links our lists up and makes it so you can only select one hero at any given time. By the way, my lists aren't actually item list nodes. I don't like those because they're not that useful. So I made my own that just extends VBox container, and its items are child nodes. You can look at the code for it in the GitHub repository if you care. Anyway, back to the menu. Whenever one of the two lists in the state is modified, we need to update our list nodes. For simplicity, I chose to just rebuild each list entirely when necessary. If you want to be more optimal, you could instead handle specific changes to the list separately, but I couldn't be bothered and wanted to keep it super simple. When the name is edited by the player, the name of the selected hero is updated in the state. When buttons are pressed, the selected hero is moved from one list in this state to the other. When the selected hero changes, we pull data out of the state and put it into the correct components. We can make this a single function call that handles multiple components like I did here, or connect a function for each control. Comes down to the same thing. What's important is that components use the state, but don't actually talk to each other directly. Always remember that. And that's basically it. To wrap things up, I manually emit each list's reactive array, so everything is initialized. And I also set the initial selected hero to null, so no hero is selected when the menu opens. And just like that, we have a working UI. What's really cool about it is that we can remove any controls from the UI, and the rest will keep working. So rearranging things or changing the menu later on when your game's design changes is really easy. And as you saw, the actual menu logic remains really simple. Each component simply communicates with the state, and that's it. Our example case here is of course quite simple, but imagine how nice a system like this is to use with more complicated UI, with more intertwined components. And, of course, this system makes completely separate UIs work together, as long as they modify the same state. Well, that about wraps this video up. There's a GitHub repository with all the code linked in the description. I hope this video was useful to you. Thanks for watching. And bye.